Okay, another self-service laptop, so I'll just stay seated.
Shall we do this? Well, the presentation also should be on the other screen. Okay, then I better do it like this. Then don't make more mess than needed.
Is it critical?
not really, but well, I can.
Do you have it on USB?
No, just have it here. But I have it.
What you prefer to do?
I think I can go with.
Yeah.
I could go with this one. That's better.
Just explain.
Assalamu alaikum. Good afternoon. My name is Marco Schmidt. I'm working for the WIPNTC in the registration service. And now, after we have solved technical problems, I would like to give you an update on the registration service. And I would like to mainly focus on IPv4 today and how to get still some IPv4. Yesterday, we spoke quite a lot of about IPv6. And that's definitely also the way to go and the future. But also, we get quite some requests, hey, how we still need IPv4. We are not ready yet with the implementation of IPv6. Can you help us? What are the possibilities? And I would like to talk a little bit about this today. And first, before I go into details, I would give you some general numbers. The WIPNTC right now has more than 9,500 members. And you see it's a pretty stable growth over the last years, even with a slight increase during the last month. And you will see in a few moments why is that. Inside of the region here, we have 641 members, LARs, so around 7% of our total membership. The biggest amount of members we have in Turkey, Iran, and Saudi Arabia, which also makes sense because these are the countries with the biggest population. And Kuwait, we currently have 30 LARs, 30 members, which is a pretty good number considering the size of Kuwait in relation to the other countries here. And probably you all are aware about that around 1 year ago, the WIPNTC reached the last /8. So we have just 1/8 IPv4 left. And this changed drastically the way how we were dealing with IPv4. Because before, we gave every member always an allocation size according to their need for a certain period. But right now, you only can get 1/22, regardless what is your need. 1/22 from the last /8, each member can get one. If you have an IPv6 allocation, rather directly from us or from an upstream provider. And we also only give it to our members. So we don't give it to independent end users that are not members, so the so-called provider independent address space, we don't hand it out anymore. And we have set aside a small part, a /16, for IXPs. And also we have a /13 set aside for some temporary assignments for events or for some experiments. And so far we have handed out already more than 2,000 of these /22s. But if you think we have 1/8 has more than 16,000 of these, so we have still quite some address space available there. And you also can see it in the next slide, which shows a little bit our pool size. And this dashed line in the middle, this marks the moment when we hit the last /8. And since then you see the blue pool, or the blue color is the pool that we have currently available. And it's going down now very slowly. So if nothing unforeseen happens, we will have this little chunk of IPv4 for all new entries, for all new members that will join us, and of course also existing members who have not requested yet. And you see there's also one yellow part, and that's even slowly increasing, because in the meantime we even still get IPv4 address space back for example, members that are closing down. We then deregister the resources as well for provider independent address space where we cannot establish a contractual relationship with them. And at a certain moment in the future, this reserved address space will also go into the available pool and will still hand it out according to the policy. So probably a /22 still for new members. So that's the good news, that there always will be a small part of IPv4 available for somebody who wants to start his business, and not always, but at least for the next years, until hopefully everybody is on IPv6. Here we have some numbers about the IPv6, the /22 allocations that we handed out so far in the region. And it's 173 allocations, which is, if you remember, we have more than 600 members, so just around 25% of the members here have requested this last /22. So definitely, if you are one of the LARs that have not requested the /22 yet, you can do it. We even can have a chat later. All what you need is you have to justify for an additional allocation, which means you have to show a usage of 80% in the current allocations, and you need to have to request an IPv6 allocation. And if you see right now, Kuwait, so far only 4 of the 30 LARs have requested their /22. So there's definitely some space waiting for you in our pool. Regarding IPv6, here you can see the numbers of allocations, IPv6 allocations that we handed out in our region. Looks a bit better than the /22 allocations, so around 50% of the members here in the Middle East have requested their IPv6 allocation. And in Kuwait, it's 12 LARs out of the 30. So, and actually, again, if you have not requested it yet, it's very easy. You just need to have a plan to start using IPv6, and you will get by default the minimum allocation size is a /32, and you can get even up to a /29 without any further justification needed. So it's very easy, and it's the first step into IPv6 land, and I can just encourage you to go there. And if you have any questions, just ask me after this session. And of course, quite often we get asked, okay, what other ways are there to get IPv4, because it takes time, the IPv6 implementation, equipment, upstream providers, testing, and so on. And you want to have your business running, your business is growing. Well, there are some ways, but unfortunately none of them is so easy like it was in the past, getting an allocation from the RIPE NCC directly. And there you can basically split it in three different ways. The first one is a merger or acquisition. The second is a transfer of an allocation from another member. Excuse me. And the third one is a legacy space transfer. And there's currently one proposal discussed that it also will be possible to transfer address space from other service regions, because this only refers to our region, which is Europe, the Middle East, and the countries that were the former Soviet Union. And it's currently not possible to transfer address space from other regions like Africa or North America, but If there would be such policy in place, this also would be an option in the future. The first way is, quite normal. If you buy a company, an internet provider that has a service running, you buy the service, and this provider also has IPv4 address space, their own PI or an own allocation, then of course you also can get this internet resources to your own account. All what we need to see is a merger agreement, is a selling contract, and we need the company registration papers from the both involved companies. And if it's a so-called provide an independent address space, so not directly an allocation, rather an address space that was handed out to an end user, independent, we would need to see an agreement, a so-called end user assignment request agreement, for that we can see that there is a contractual relation established towards the RIPE NCC. The second option is a so-called normal transfer of an allocation, because we have quite some members that got address space in the past, and in the meantime they changed their business model, and they have free unused address space. And while they have it free and don't need it anymore, somebody else might need it. So then why not find a way to hand it over? And it is possible, and all what we need is we need to see that the address space is not in use anymore. We also need to see that the LAR that needs to get the address space really has a justified need for it, also for the size. And also there are two ways. You can get you make a permanent transfer, or you can even make it temporary, so that you say, okay, this allocation is unused. You can have it for 1 year, and then it can be handed back. And what we need to do for this, it's a signed RIPE NCC transfer agreement. It can be found on our website. Also, we need the company registration papers for both members. And as I said before, the LAR that wants to get the address space has to send us a request before to say, I would like to get this /16 because I plan to develop this service or have this service running. My customer numbers are like this, and based on this, I expect the need. And then we will have a look at it, we will approve it, and it will be justified. And the last option is the so-called legacy space. That's a space that was handed out before the existence of the whole IR system, so before the existence of the RIPE NCC. And as it was handed out before us and before all the policies were in place, we also don't have any influence on this or any control over this. So it's possible to simply transfer it. And it would be important, of course, for data accuracy that it's still correctly registered in the RIPE database. And this we can do if a so-called legacy space agreement is signed. And then we keep the record, or we will update the details in the RIPE database about the new owner of this legacy space. And other than that, we are not involved on any transfer details. The RIPE NCC has created a tool, because of course I said before, some LARs might have unused address space and some other might need it, but it's difficult to find out who has some space available, and also who to contact if you need address space. One option is the so-called listing service. That's a service that we offer for members only inside of the LAR portal. And there you can post your demand, or also your offer that you have some address space available. And the numbers that are posted below are not correct right now. I just updated it recently, but due to technical problems, I was not able to show it. It's right now. In the listing service, we have around 300,000 IPs offered, and almost a /8, so much more than 60 million IPs are asked for. So there's quite a big difference. But at least that's one way to find a partner for exchange or handover, transfer, and allocation. And of course, it must follow the right policies. So again, we will check: is there the need, and is the address space not in use right now? That's a screenshot how the listing service looks. So here, let me see. Here you can just simply, once you're logged in, you can click and you can post your demand or your offer. And then below you will see this information, how much address space is currently offered, how much is requested. If you click on it, you get the contact details of the LAR, and then you can get in contact with them and say, hey, how we can find an agreement. Basically here you can see just a very simple web form, and then everything further you can then follow up directly with your business partner. Here I have some numbers about how many allocations we are currently managed. So because once the two parties agreed and also it was approved from our side, we will change all the details in the VIPE database to the new holder of this allocation. And since October last year, we start publishing also these details. And here you just see the pure numbers, how many allocations were transferred. And maybe it's a bit early because it's less than a year, but you can see already a trend. It's not a huge amount of allocations that get currently transferred, but lately, so in the last months, we had around 15 allocations per month that get transferred from one member to another. Here, as I said, you only see the numbers of allocations, not about the size. It's mainly the biggest transfer size was a /15, but the main amount is rather small allocations, so /20, /19. That's currently the more typical sizes that get transferred between LARs. Now I would like to talk a little bit about VIPE policies. It's normally a topic that many people are not so familiar with, but all our acting, whatever we do, is based on policies, and of course so also transfers. And there were some recent changes that then influence how we have to deal with transfers, and also there might be some future changes that will also then, again, we have to adapt it in our internal procedures, and depend how it goes, it will even make it more easier to hand over address space between our members. And one was that it was accepted, the transparency in address space transfer. And that's from what I also just got the numbers earlier. And if you click on the link below, you can find my presentation on the MINOC website. You will get exactly the same information, what transfers were done so far and between what members it was done. Another recent policy change was that we reverted the run out fairly, because we normally, before we hit the last /8, we were handing out address space according to the need for a certain period. And as there was one policy in place that as closer we get to the estimated point that we would reach the last /8, always the allocation period was shortened. So we only gave at the end address space for the next 3 months, the estimated need for the next 3 months. This is now reverted. So now the allocation period is 12 months again. So if you plan to manage an allocation transfer, we will look into your need for the next 12 months. And even regarding an assignment, an active network, we even check, okay, what is what will be the utilization after 12 months, which should be at least 50%. So, and if an assignment even is bigger than that, then of course, even an according allocation would be justified. And yeah, this makes it of course more easier to justify one allocation size that you would like to get transferred. There are also some policy proposals that are right now under discussion, so they are not accepted yet. If they get implemented, they also will have an impact how allocations and address space, IPv4 address space, can be transferred. One is 2012-02, which would actually make it possible to transfer address space between regions, so from the RIPE NCC to other regions, but also towards the RIPE NCC. The main idea is, of course, that the policies must be so kind of compatible between the two regions, and that the parties must apply to their policies in their region. However, currently it's a so-called review phase, but this policy right now is a little bit stuck, so it's not clear how it moves on and when it will be implemented and if it will be implemented. Another proposal that is right now going on is that there will be no restrictions anymore about end-user assignments in allocations to be transferred, because I mentioned earlier, right now an allocation must be empty before it can be handed over from one LAR to another. But we had sometimes the case that an ISP is not an LAR at the begin and get an assignment, so get an address block from an upstream provider. And in one moment they decide, okay, we want to become a member ourselves, and they even agree with the upstream provider that the upstream provider split the allocation and would hand over this block to the new member. But right now that's conflicting with the policy, because the policy only allows that a transfer of an allocation is empty, which is not, because it's in use by this ISP, or if there's a merger or a network acquisition, which is also not, because the ISP is not selling his business, it just simply want to move the address space. And this proposal actually would solve this problem, because there is no requirement anymore that the allocation is empty. And that's currently in the discussion phase. We probably will publish next week the documentation, and then it goes to the review phase, and once this is accepted, it would ease quite a lot the allocation transfers between members. There are some other policy proposals that will have some influence. One is right now quite heavily discussed on the mailing list. It's the removal of the need requirement, because I mentioned before the receiving party has to justify why they want to get a /16. They have to show us the need or whatever size they would like to get. If this proposal would get accepted, that's no question anymore. We just would need to get information. Yes, two parties have agreed on a transfer. Please update our web database. That's it. And another one, we also have a policy proposal about the legacy space. That also would ensure a service towards legacy space holder, which also would make it more easier if legacy space gets transferred, to keep everything updated towards the RIPE database, and also that we can provide service to legacy holders. And of course, sometimes we get questions so about the transfers, that people say, hey, why you allow this? People gonna make money with IPv4. This was a public resource. They should not sell it, and so on. But our stand is, we are not involved, and we are also not interested on what agreement an allocation get transferred. Our main objective is that the RIPE database is accurate. And there's also nothing in the policy that would stop an allocation transfer, or that we cannot say, hey, you cannot do this because you want to make some business out of it. And probably people would do it anyhow if there would be kind of a restriction. But then they would not tell us about it, and then the RIPE database would get incorrect. So for us, it's important, if a transfer takes place, that the RIPE policies are followed, and that we know who is actually using the address space. Everything else is a matter between the parties involved. And so if allocation gets donated, or if there's any financial transaction involved, that's not important to us, that's not relevant for us. What next? I already showed you we want to increase the transparency, and we did already that we publish what transfers take place. We also have on our website information about so-called recognized brokers, so third parties that help members to arrange a transfer. Basically, these brokers that are on the website, they agreed that they will follow the right policies. That's the only thing. So brokers must not be listed on our website to be able to be involved on address-based transfers. You even don't need a broker, of course. If there are two parties and they can manage it themselves, that's fine. But this at least gives you an indication that these people say, yes, we follow the right policies, and yeah, we can do something for you to transfer the address space. And we also want to simplify the whole transfer process that's currently upcoming, so that there's just one single transfer form on the LAR portal. Something what I really can recommend you, I told you right now about all these different policies that are ongoing, and often people are not so keen on all this policy development process, but it's something very important because, as you see, it has a lot of influence on how the RIPE entity has to deal with it, and also at the end how you can run your business and how you can arrange the handling of your internet resources. So if you would like to know more about it, just inscribe to the Atrocy Policy Working Group mailing list, and then you can see what's going on there. And of course, you can even, for ongoing policy proposals, you can raise your support or you can raise your opposition. So if you think for example, the removal of the need requirement is a good thing, you can post this, or if you don't agree with it, you also can post it. And that's very important to help the community, the RIPE community, to take the right decision regarding the policy development and at the end also how we deal with our internet resources. Yeah, and finally at the end I collected you some links that contain useful information. You can, as I said, you can find it in my documentation, in my presentation that is online available, where you can find the transfer agreements, more guidance, what needs to be done, what information we need, what are the requirements about the transfers, and yeah, what's going on in the right policy land. And this brings me to the end of my presentation. Are there any questions?
Freddy Künstler, Init7. Could you please go back to the slide where we see the available IPv4 pool?
Yeah.
That one, yes. Yeah. Do you have forecast how long there will be IPv4 space left? Since August 24th, 2012, the line looks pretty flat to me, and it could be go for the foreseeable future flat like this.
Well, I mean, right now, if you calculate, during the last year, we handed out around 2,000 resources, and we have still 14,000 left. So if we do 2,000 per year still, at least give us 7 more years, and taking account some potential returned address space, even a little bit longer. But of course, it's also very difficult to really forecast. There might also come a moment where we get even a growing membership number, and then it might also go faster.
But this brings me then to the next question, and I think this addresses everybody in the room. How long do we want to have V4 space left? I mean, 7 years, that sounds very long, and considering that it still ranges returned, I'd rather have, I mean, to force the deployment of V6, I'd rather have it zero by within maybe 2 or 3 years, so that we see the effect. But as long as V4 is available, people still can get V4 and they can live with V4 forever. So I think that's a topic we have to discuss in the policy group, in the address policy group. But I mean, just as a thought.
Yeah, definitely. But as you said, that's currently the policy, and we have to follow the policy. And it is clear that IPv4, IPv6 will have to coexist for quite a while. I think nobody has a crystal ball to look on it how long it will be, but considering that there always will be new companies who want to enter the internet market, it still would be good that they have this little I mean, with a /22, you cannot do so much, but at least it will ensure you one, yeah, connection to the IPv4 land, and I think that's not so bad. And I mean, also right now I just make a very simple calculation of what happened in the last year, but it's also very difficult to forecast what will be in the next years. But if the community would like to change it, then definitely the way to do it is via the policy, network policy.
Yeah, George, Freddy, your issue is easily solvable. We should agree in address policy working group that we should start allocating PI space again for /8, and this space will go out in no time. But my real question here is, what is this millions of IPv4 addresses reserved, and why it is thickening?
Well, in this yellow part is the /13 for the temporary assignments. It's also the /16 for the internet exchange points, and also all the address space that is currently returned, because we keep it in quarantine. And at a certain moment in the future, we will then transfer it into the available address pool. But that's basically the yellow part. That's also why it's slowly increasing, that because we have we have certain activities running that sometimes can result into the return of address space, like simple when a member goes bankrupt and stops closes its account, then the address space goes back to our pool. Some other questions?
You did actually mention a good point indeed. We've got address space specifically earmarked for IXPs, right? So yeah. If you want to start an internet exchange point, you will get your IPv4 addresses.
Exactly. So there's, for internet exchange points, there is a little chunk of IPv4 PI still available. You get a /24 at least, and depend of the memberships that the IXP has, it can go up to a /22. So that's still available, 1/16. Okay. Then thank you very much.
Other questions? No. All right. Thanks very much, Marco.